Hi, welcome to this week's special episode of The Shtick, where we move out of the studio and we're somewhere on the other side of Melbourne, where Anita Lester has an abode. And I'm here to interview Anita because I have a great amount of admiration for the diversity, the depth, and also the wonderful talent that she portrays in all her work. And I'd like to introduce the whole world, especially the viewers of The Shtick, to Anita Lester.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thank you. You are so humble. I am humbled to be in your presence.
Thank you.
Actually, because I've followed your career over the years and known your family for a long time.
It's true.
And I think you have grown up to be a very, very... I was going to say precocious, but then
prolific.
That's the right. That's the word I was looking for. A very prolific
bit
artist.
Precocious. As well. Yeah.
So you do art.
I do.
You do music. You do animation. You do poetry, and you're also a writer and storyteller.
Mm.
So, how did you get to be so talented?
I mean, I don't believe it's a talent thing. I think it's the path that I've followed is this arc of storytelling. And even though there's all these different mediums that it carries across through, it's there is a thread through everything that I do. So
it's a red thread.
It's a red thread.
Where does the red thread come from? Is that Kabbalah thing?
Kind of. It's Buddhist.
Buddhists do that as well.
I have a tattoo of a red thread. I shouldn't say that for the the Jewish viewers. But
I didn't even notice.
No, everyone thinks it's a band. But I think for me it's... There's this bit of poetic prose about having five red threads that are connected to your soulmates, and I always felt that about my art. You know, it's like I've got this one hand with these five red threads and I'm constantly kind of puppeteering all of them. But for me, it feels the same. It seems different on the outside and it seems like I'm a big overachiever, but actually it just comes out that way, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love your work, and I remember having you on the show many years ago in a band called Me and the Grown-Ups.
Yeah, that's right. My first band.
That was your first band?
Yeah.
And you actually did quite a bit of work in that. You did two LPs and one EP.
Yeah. We did really well, actually. I sort of, as a 19-year-old, I didn't quite realise that that's what music... Like, I thought everyone did that. Everyone sold out the Spiegel tent. Everyone toured around Australia and... I had a really good experience with Jonathan Dreyfus and Adrian Sergovich, who are both now amazing composers for film and television. So I got kind of educated by the fire of people who are incredibly gifted and talented in composition. So it was quite an interesting way of starting my music journey. Yeah.
So that really inspired you.
Yeah, definitely.
Took you to the next level.
Definitely.
Where you created a project through the title of Lester the Fierce.
Yeah.
Hey.
Hey. Like Alexander the Great. You were asking me where that came from. For me, I, you know, Me and the Grown-Ups was very much like a classical folk based project.
Mm-hmm.
Both things, and a bit of jazz as well, and really what I do love at my core, but I wanted to explore the rock world and maybe a bit more of the pop world in my own way, and that's where Lester the Fierce came from, and, that was a fun project.
And then in the middle of that, you got called to the United States for a record deal.
Yeah, I got a deal in the States.
Yay!
Whoopee. Sounds really romantic.
Yeah,
but isn't it's, romantic.
It's a big pit.
Yeah, it is.
Unless you reach the very top and you get all the right rides, it's very difficult to break through.
Yeah, definitely.
And then in 2017, you made a revival because you were working with your mother there for a while in art and other projects.
I mean, actually, I've on and off worked with my mum's business, which she runs an art school called Art Encounters. But I was living in London for 3 years.
Oh, I didn't realise that.
Yeah, there you go, Lynn.
What were you doing in London?
I was making art, actually. I was working in the arts and...
You weren't doing music at that stage?
No, not really. I was writing poetry. I've always written poetry. I mean, that's been the constant since I was like 12, probably.
That's your underlying...
Yeah.
Endeavor.
Yeah, but not for anyone else, you know. So I was still writing and felt that expression, but As far as the music stuff, when I didn't feel like I wanted to be in the industry anymore, you know, selling myself, even though it seems to be the thing that I always come back to.
Yeah.
It was this thing that felt counterintuitive, and I just needed a break. I actually kind of, besides those two releases in the middle there, it was almost 6 years that I took off music, yeah.
Mm. And then you released Man and Last Day.
Mm-hmm. That's
the
right.
Two singles that you did.
Yeah.
And then you, in 2019, last year, you released some more works.
Yeah, so I released... In the middle of, in 2016, my brother came to me at the end of the year. He said, you know, I've got this opportunity to make some video work in Israel.
Mm.
Do you want to do a collaboration? And so I wrote some music and I put out these two songs and he made these amazing music videos. Mm. He's such a visionary.
We have to mention Yoav Lester, who has, you've got a company called Broken Wings.
Yeah, I mean, we... Any film projects that we do, we put under the title that is Broken Wing. Mm. It's just easy that way.
Yeah, we're going to show some clips during this whole episode, and one of them, two of them that I really love, was Man and Last Day, which is
going to go.
We're going to take us out with that, and then also the other thing we'll talk about. More of your music, your painting, your poetry.
Okay.
And also the recent show that you did, the women who sing or girls.
Ladies who sing.
I never know if it's women, ladies or girls. Ladies who sing.
Alliteration.
We'll be back after the break with more of Anita Lester. So cold.